Welcome back, Hnrs. Welcome back to 6:58 on a Thursday morning. Now, all right, anyway, so we did a great job in class covering a lot of really good stuff, going over a lot of good content, material, talking about the growth of Rome following the Punic Wars, right? I really liked how y'all like engaged with me and talked to me about like Hannibal and Hamilcar and digging out your own eyeball and all this other fun stuff. So I talked about Hannibal crossing the Alps, talked about a couple of the big battles, Cannae and Zama. I talked about Scipio Africanus and how he's going to skip on down to Africa and he's going to actually invade Northern Africa, earning himself the last name Africanus. And it's actually a funny little thing, funny little connection. It was his grandson that was the one that was there and started the invasion during the Third Punic War and literally destroyed all of Carthage. Because remember, for 50 straight years, it was Rome is fantastic, but we must destroy Carthage. Now, so the big thing, though, going into it is that they're going to literally knock out their biggest rival in the Mediterranean at the time. No more do they have to worry about somebody trying to invade them directly, come at them with a navy, destroy their trade routes, sanction them in any way. So Rome is going to be kind of left open to expand anywhere and everywhere it feels and seems fit. And so they're going to start expanding into Greece, Macedonia, Southwest Asia, and they're going to get into all these crazy wars, once with this guy named Pyrrhus, who literally came up with this thing called a Pyrrhic victory, where basically, like, he would beat Romans an army, but his entire army would be destroyed in that victory, so it's like, oh, well, I'm going to lose the next one. So, like, it's a very, very important thing that we understand, that the Romans are then going to begin their expansion, right? Now, in this process, when they start doing this, they leave a lot of places in ruins, but they do divide the republic into a system of provinces, and a governor would be appointed to rule each one. Now, of course, throughout Roman history, you're going to have some really, really good governors and some really, really bad governors, but this is like an element of Roman bureaucracy, right? So the idea that the republic back in Rome would then rule over these different areas and appoint governors to rule over these non-citizens, right? So most of them were never allowed to be citizens, especially the ones outside of Italy, not up until 212 AD when Caracalla, the Roman emperor, extended citizenship to everyone. But the people of these new provinces had to pay taxes, indemnities to Rome, and a bunch of them were actually taken in as slaves. And we can actually see this entire prospect whenever we're looking at the ruins of Carthage. Carthage was a mighty city, a beautiful city, a massive city unto its own, which could have been the Rome of Africa. But the Romans had to come and destroy the whole thing, salt the land, stab a spear into a patch of grass, and do all this other crazy stuff, right? So the thing about the Romans, though, is this process of slavery, enslavement, bringing in labor, it's going to benefit one particular class. It's also going to cause a massive amount of issues that go into the city of Rome and affect the people of Rome, right? So looking at this right here by 117 AD, this is how large Rome gets. So this is following the reign of Caesar, which I get to talk to y'all about next class. But I do get to talk to y'all about Caesar next class. I'm very, very excited. I'm going to bring out some candy. It's going to be a great day. Now, anyway. Excuse me. The big thing going into it, though, is this is far after that. This is actually closer to the reign of Trajan and as well as Marcus Aurelius, okay? So looking at the entire conduct of the Roman Empire, though, that there are going to be some massive effects with this concept of taking over all this area, right? But now we're particularly talking about the effects left behind from the Punic Wars right now. So the effects left behind from when Hannibal ransacked Italy for 16 years. The effects left behind from when they won this baby war up front with a small navy that they had developed from old broken boats, right? So the problems with Roman conquest is due to the fact that manpower, first and foremost, has been heavily and significantly lost, right? Many soldiers are dying during this like wars of expansion. Also on the front or on the back end of it as well is that many of these soldiers like had to be the ones that supported their families. So when they died, they left families behind that had no male income earner at the time and no like head of the household and no, which sounds really sexist to describe it or say it like that. But still, in general, it's important to understand that like they lost a significant amount of soldiers due to these wars of expansions. And then also the Roman Constitution, quote unquote, which isn't even really a thing, right? So as we know, there is no written Constitution of Rome. But basically it's more like Roman tradition was only for one city-state, right? So the Roman Republic with its Senate and its consuls and its tribunes and its veto powers and its dictator that comes in during times of extreme war, those things were only meant to rule the city-state of Rome, much like the Athenian government was only meant to rule the Athenian government, right? So in the Athenian city-state. So as they expanded, this Republican government brought into a lot of questions like, well, what about these new people? What about these like people that were fighting in the military but aren't citizens, right? They don't get to vote, but they're being heavily affected by these wars. And so it brought up a lot of questions, and it's also kind of really, really messed up everything because it wasn't built for a fledgling empire. It was just for a small city-state. But then the biggest group of people that caused the biggest amount of like, not destruction, but the biggest amount of showing the weakness of the Roman Republic is this group of people right here, the veterans of these wars. It has been thousands of years, and we still have not figured out how to properly take care, manage, and like deem it appropriate to help the veterans of any country, right? So, because a lot of times, veterans have a lot of things to deal with that most normal people in society don't have to deal with, right? We're talking about traumatic experience. We're talking about property destruction. We're talking about being asked to do things that they feel are morally reprehensible, which affects their mental state. Like, the same thing was going on in Rome, right? The veterans of these wars, though, the Punic Wars, feel extremely unsupported and taken advantage of, right? Because there's a very weird thing about the Roman army at this point. You need to understand something really important. The Roman military at this point was barely not a hoplite army, right? And a hoplite army means like, you know, heavily armored Greek soldiers, you know what I'm talking about? Like, so it's like this idea that, let me put it to you this way. So when we're looking at Greece, okay, they didn't have multiple units and cavalries and all these new weapons that the Romans had. But the Romans did borrow something from Greece that they heavily used, and it's the hoplite formations using a somewhat similar phalanx system, except Romans would use what was called a shield wall. Now, the issue with this whole thing, though, was that Roman soldiers at this time of the Punic Wars had to be from wealthier plebeian or patrician families because they had to buy all of their equipment. They also had to serve for 10 years, right, and hope that they actually stayed alive because it was a citizen-based army, not a professional army. Professional armies are very, very different, right? The citizen army that was around during the Republic period of Rome was one where it was, you didn't enter into it for a lifelong profession. You were told you had to come into it, and then you had to buy all your equipment, right? So during this time period, the veterans felt very, very unsupported. Also, if the veterans did survive 10 straight years of warfare, when they went back to their homes, who was just in Italy ransacking everything for 16 years, and then all the way up till decades later, things still weren't necessarily fixed? The countryside was in absolute shambles, right? Soldiers are coming back to garbage because it's not just Hannibal. Later wars of expansion, people tried to attack Rome and burn down farms and cities then as well. Like, soldiers are coming back to seeing their farm that used to have their wife, their children, and all their stuff. It's destroyed. Maybe their family has been killed as well. And so all they have as equity or property is the land itself, but they can't do anything with it, right? So what's going on then is some wealthy guys are coming along and they're profiting off of these wars by going up to these veterans, knowing that they have no other option, and telling them, I will buy your land from you, and I will use my new slave labor that we got from expansionary wars that you're responsible for actually growing the empire to actually occupy this whole area. So think about it this way. Let's look at it like a dynamic thing. Let's say hypothetically Damari was like a Roman soldier, right? Damari went off and lived for 10 years, and it was because of people like Damari that Rome had expanded to be as great and as large as it was, right? She won battles. She was out there destroying the Carthaginians. She was the one destroying the Greeks in the like major Piraeus battles, right? These are things that were the veterans' responsibility. They did it. Rome is great because of them. But she comes home and her farm is destroyed. Her area is destroyed. Her family and kids have been wiped out, right? And then you got, like, who's going to walk up to her and ask her? Oh, then you got Delaney, right? And then Delaney Trosclair walks up. And Delaney is not like Damari. Damari is a plebe. Delaney is a patrician. Delaney is super wealthy, right? Delaney's farm was fine because remember, Hannibal avoided taking over senators' farms thinking that it would inspire poor people to hate them. Bad mistake. So, like, Delaney walks up to Damari and is like, oh, well, Damari, I have all of these new slaves that are working on top of my, like, on my farmland that from, like, Greece and Macedonia and places that we have taken over. And they're working my farmland, and so I'm making tons of money. So how about you let me buy your land from you? Well, the Damari's got an issue right now, and she, like, wants to be able to charge a lot for this land, but it's burned, it's destroyed, it's messed up, right? So in the long run, she has to sell this property to Delaney, because she has no other option, right? Delaney's got Greek slaves that are tutoring her children, right? Delaney's got so much money she doesn't know what to do with it, right? So, like, and Damari, the one that is responsible for giving Delaney money and other workers and all this stuff, is now the one out of a job, is now the one out of, like, home, out of, like, in a homeless situation, is now the one really struggling. And where is she going to go? Where is she going to go? Where? Well, a lot of them started returning back to their generals, right? Damari would go back to her general, and her general is Lily Bourgeois, right? So, like, and Lily Bourgeois is like, it is unfair and disgusting what the Roman government is doing to our people. And so what happened is he had a lot of civil wars breaking out, right? A lot of civil wars against a lot of, like, for example, there were slave revolts that were parts of civil wars. There was the first, second, and third servile wars is what they were called. You had different revolts going on as well in this entire situation, including ones like the Sullan Civil Wars, right? So, like, Damari returns back to her general, and they basically become roaming mercenary armies that end up getting into wars and, like, fights with one another. And then, like, the Roman government is struggling to try and keep these civil wars suppressed. And I'm not kidding. It was, like, so many civil wars. It was civil war, civil war, civil war. And then the problem was, though, also, is since these wealthy Romans are still buying up all this land from veterans with no money, and veterans also, where are they going to go? Like, if they're not in the middle of one of these civil wars, where are they going to go? Where is somebody going to go? Let's look at another veteran we could say. Let's say, like, I don't know, let's say Abby Ragusa was a veteran of one of these wars, too, right? And she's not like Damari. She already had to sell her land off to somebody else. And then Abby now has to try and find a job, right? So she has to go to, where is she going to go? She's going to go to Rome. She's going to go to the city of Rome to try and find work. Problem is Abby's not alone. There are thousands of other Abby's veterans looking for work and stuff like that. And they're flooding into the city of Rome. And so there's people without work and without anything to do. And the only job that Abby can find is a person that, like, collects the waste buckets from latrines to take to, I know latrines a toilet, like, so gross, there's duty buckets and pee buckets. So, and you have to take the pee buckets to the laundry, like, people in Rome, because apparently they wash all their clothes and pee. So, like, now, the big thing about it, though, is that everyone struggling in these veterans are super taken advantage of. But then you're going to see one of the most important events in Roman history, and it's the rise of these two brothers, right? These two brothers show up, and they become the tide-shifting, tide-switching, most important thing that happens that leads into the death of the Republic and also the progress of the plebes as well, okay? So the big thing about it is I need you to write this down as a title, okay? And put Rise of the, all right? And then in all capital letters, I need you to write their last name. And their last name goes like this. G-R-A-C-C-I. It's Rise of the Gracchi. Not Gracchi, not Gracie, not Gracchi. It's the Gracchi, right? So the Gracchi are these two brothers that show up that try to shift the tides of the Roman Republic and make it so the veterans are better, like, cared for, and you'll see, like, some kind of foreshadowing that's going to happen as well. So in the long run, though, really quickly, we need to talk about who they are. Their names are Tiberius and Gaius, and they both are very, very famous, very, very wealthy, very well-to-do, and they get elected to become tribunes. Well, wait a minute. If these guys both become tribunes, that means that they're both from what class? Good job, Kirsten!
Bagel's here. You must not know about me. You must not know about me. I could have another you in a minute. Matter of fact, he'll be here in a minute, baby. You must not know about me. You must not.
Yeah, that's right, Kirsten, looking out, right? Good job, Kirsten. Best answer around. One of the coolest students I know, hands down, bar none, all day. All right, so now look. But the big thing is she's right. Tiberius and Gaius Gracchus were both plebes, right? So it is very, very rare in Roman history that you see the rise of plebes. So whenever you actually see this happen, you need to understand that being a famous plebe is a very, very important deal in the history of Rome. So Tiberius Gracchus is the brother that comes first. Now, also to give you a heads up, they're not twin brothers. They're not close in age. They're actually pretty far apart in age, right? So Tiberius Gracchus is the older brother, shows up first. He wants to pass a law through the Roman Republic that would issue and strip land from wealthy people, giving it to veterans so that they could actually create farmable communities of veterans where they would have like a work and like property and a way to support themselves, right? He finances this bill to help them, sends it through law, and it even gets approved, right? But the problem is in this process, he angered a ton of people, right? And you got to think about it. Is this not a genius idea? People like Delaney and people like have way too much land as it is, right? So we need to maybe just cut a piece of it off. And, oh, I don't know, redistribute some of that wealth, keep people from hoarding all of that wealth, right? So we want to just take just a little piece of Delaney's land and give it back to Damari, rather than having Damari have to just go back and risk her life all the time in the military. This makes complete sense. Why would you not do these things? It is such a good idea. But who really quickly are people like Delaney related to? They're related to the senators, right? And the senators are the ones that are the highest ranking patricians who rule for life and own all of this land. So they become furious with Tiberius Gracchus. And then Tiberius Gracchus goes to try and get elected as a tribune again. And what ends up happening is while he was escorting some of his votes back to Rome, a pack of senators jumped him and beat him to death with wooden chairs, right? They literally picked up pieces of broken chairs and beat him to death with them. That's right. We're talking on Rome crime right now. This just happened. A group of patricians killed a plebe because the plebe wanted to help veterans. What is going on? Like, you're seeing these wealthy people turn into basically like that mob that they always said that they were afraid of, right? And then Gaius Gracchus comes on years later, and Gaius Gracchus earns even a bigger following than his brother ever did, right? He actually wants to do all of his brother's reforms, finish them off, push them all the way through, get more land for veterans, but he also wants to extend citizenship to anybody that lives on the Italian peninsula, right? Because by doing this, it would limit the number of slaves that are coming into Rome. It would also free many of the slaves that were currently in Rome, right? So the thing about it is this angers the Senate even more, even though this guy has a great idea. Gaius Gracchus comes up with this idea and is like, oh, wait, I know what I'll do. How about we'll just like make it so we kind of equalize like labor, and we'll make it so you have to pay those people instead of getting their labor for free. Oh, that'll be a grand idea. Well, what happened to him? He also gets killed in cold blood by the Senate, sort of, right? Here's how the entire story goes, right? So the way the story goes is that Gaius Gracchus earned a massive following, right? A huge group of people that would follow around after. It's almost like if Kirsten were to be leading a political party, right? Of course people are going to listen to her, right? They're going to like show up and they're going to like be like, what do you want us to do, right? So the thing about it was Gaius Gracchus wasn't even there the day that the thing that led to his death got caused, right? So a bunch of Gaius Gracchus's followers were actually just walking around through the Forum of Rome, right? And they were walking up a hill, and then another enemy follower from a different group showed up and starts taunting them, right? And they're like, oh, Gaius Gracchus, yeah, right, like he's gonna help you out, you stupid plebes, y'all don't even know what you're doing, blah, 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 blah. And he starts talking a bunch of junk to all of Gaius Gracchus's followers. They shove him off and they're like, get away from me. He then goes and gets the guts and like entrails from an animal that had been sacrificed, and he runs up to him and starts talking crap, and he's waving these guts around. He's just like, boogity, 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 boogity. And then the guys crack his like followers that had enough of it by that point. They pull their stylus pencils out of their togas and they run up and they stab this guy to death. The Senate now had the crime that they needed to declare Gaius and all of his followers enemies of the Roman state, declared them all traitors, and started arresting all of them, and had plans to go and arrest Gaius right here as well. Gaius, though, to head off being arrested and executed like his brother, he actually had one of his servants hold his sword up, and he dove on top of it. He literally like just fell on top of his own sword. So the Gaius Gracchus and Tiberius Gracchus reforms, though, the reforms of the Gracchi, are going to trigger yet another civil war, right? Now, this time, yet again, it becomes a civil war between generals, and a lot of these generals were former consuls, right? So one of them, who's very, very important, was named Gaius Marius, right? So, like, write that name down, Gaius Marius, G-A-I-U-S-M-A-R-I-U-S, right? Gaius Marius ended up having a massive civil war against this guy. Lucius Cornelius Sulla, right? So they had a huge war against each other because Gaius Marius wanted to support the Gracchi followers, the plebs, the veterans. He wants to support all the reforms that they're trying to enact to help these people. He also is responsible for refunctioning the entire Roman military and creating and finalizing the legion system, creating a standard uniform, creating a standard issue, making it so they were better taken care of and getting them paid more. But then there was this guy, this big jerk named Sulla. And Sulla hates Gaius Marius' reforms because Sulla is a former senator. Sulla is a very wealthy person, right? Sulla is a part of this group called the Optimates, right? Like these people that are super wealthy, super rich, and they have this political party where they only support their own, right? Sulla and Gaius Marius end up having a massive civil war against each other, and unfortunately, Sulla ends up winning, right? And in this whole process, a lot of crazy stuff goes down. Sulla, after beating Gaius Marius in battle, then uses his new Roman army to invade directly at Rome, and he takes over the city of Rome by force. And instead of waiting for a war to be enacted, he appoints himself dictator, right? Legit, appoints himself dictator. And when he comes in, he says, I am now the dictator of Rome to bring peace back to this place. And he presses the Senate underneath his thumb, and he starts executing huge numbers of people, right? 9,000 people were executed from the time when Sulla took over as dictator to the time when he retired about 9 years later, right? Executed that he thought were any threat to him or the Senate's power, right? He took away the power, the tribune's power. He took away the veto power. He took away all this other stuff. And it was, well, it was later brought back after he died, thank God. He also, though, like, raised the, like, age that you would need to be elected to public office and all this other crazy stuff. And in this huge way, he was creating an enemy. But since he was inspiring so much terror, this enemy had to run out of Rome to save himself. And we'll talk about him tomorrow. So that's the guy who actually, like, he was an enemy with. How, like, the thing about it is, though, is, like, he just enacted this huge reign of basic terror throughout Rome, which would lead to the death of the Republic because of the rise of a new figure. And we'll talk about those guys, and we'll talk about that dude, who's very, very important, tomorrow. I'll see y'all then. Can't wait. Y'all have a good one.